His fruit was sweet to my taste. Faith in the scripture is spoken of under the emblem of all the senses. It is sight, look unto me and be ye saved. It is hearing, hear and your soul shall live. Faith is smelling, all thy garments smell of myrrh and alloys and cassia. Thy name is an ointment poured forth. Faith is a spiritual touch. By this faith, the woman came behind and touched the hem of Christ's garment. And by this we handle the things of the good word of life. Faith is equally the Spirit's taste. How sweet are thy words to my taste, yea, sweeter than honey to my lips. Except a man eat my flesh, said Christ, and drink my blood, there is no life in him. This taste is faith in one of its highest operations. One of the first performances of faith is hearing. We hear the voice of God not with outward ear alone, but with the inward ear. We hear it as God's word, and we believe it to be so. That is the hearing of faith. And then our mind looketh upon the truth as it is presented to us. That is to say, we understand it. We perceive its meaning. That is the seeing of faith. Next, we discover its preciousness. We begin to admire it and find how fragrant it is. That is, faith in its smell. Then we appropriate the mercies which are prepared for us in Christ. That is, faith in its touch. Hence, follow the enjoyments, peace, delight, communion, which are faith in its taste. Any of these acts of faith is saving. To hear Christ's voice as the sure voice of God is the soul will save us. But that which gives true enjoyment is the aspect of faith wherein Christ, by holy taste, is received into us and made by inward and spiritual apprehension of his sweetness and preciousness to be the food of our souls. It is then we sit under his shadow with great delight and find his fruit sweet to our taste. If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. These words may answer your scruples, devout reader, concerning the ordinances. Perhaps you say, I should be afraid to be baptized. It is such a solemn thing to avow myself to be dead with Christ and buried with him. I should not feel at liberty to come to the Master's table. I should be afraid of eating and drinking damnation unto myself, not discerning the Lord's body. Ah, poor trembler! Jesus has given you liberty. Be not afraid. If a stranger came to your house, he would not stand at the door or wait in the hall. He would not dream of intruding unbidden into your parlor. He is not at home, but your child makes himself very free about the house. And so it is with the child of God. A stranger may not intrude where a child may venture. When the Holy Ghost has given you to feel the spirit of adoption, you may come to Christian ordinances without fear. The same rule holds good of the Christian's inward privileges. You think, poor seeker, that you are not allowed to rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory? If you are permitted to get inside Christ's door or sit at the bottom of his table, you'll be well content. Ah, but you shall not have less privileges than the very greatest. God makes no difference in his love to his children. A child is a child to him. He will not make him a hired servant, but he shall feast upon the fatted calf. And he shall have the music and the dancing as much as he had never gone astray. When Jesus comes into the heart, he issues a general license to be glad in the Lord. No chains are worn in the court of King Jesus. Our admission into full privilege may be gradual, but it is sure. Perhaps our reader is saying, I wish I could enjoy the promise and walk at liberty in my Lord's commands. If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. Loose the chains of thy neck, O captive daughter, for Jesus makes thee free.